So one of the very intriguing stories about, is it a commensal or is it a pathogen, is Helicobacter. Mm-hmm. Again, when I was in medical school, we were cutting out people's stomachs to stop ulcers. Mm-hmm. Nobody believed that it was anything infectious.
Yeah.
And then we discovered it was.
Yeah, yeah. And so thanks to the seminal work by people like Barry Marshall with his famous...
Self-treatment. Or not treatment, exactly.
No, self-inoculation. Yeah, that's right. We learned that Helicobacter pylori caused things like stomach ulcers, gastritis, and then later stomach cancer. And it became seen as a villain, as something that we needed to eradicate. And then later work by people like Marty Blazer showed that it has positive sides as well. It comes with a reduced risk of esophageal cancer. And it is, in fact, an old companion to humanity. It has accompanied us out of Africa. It's been part of us for tens of thousands of years.
So we are its habitat.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, there are many other Helicobacter strains that affect species and strains that infect other types of mammals as well. So it is, it does live within us. And I think it is a very good example for understanding that there is really no such thing as a good or a bad microbe. Mm. Often it's exactly
trade-offs,
the same.
Trade-offs.
Absolutely. You know, so we have an increased risk of stomach cancer versus a lower risk of esophageal cancer. In one of Blazer's papers, he shows that the net effect on all cause mortality was null. It just balances out. And one critical thing here is that it's not different strains of Helicobacter that cause these benefits and these harms. It's actually the same ones that are both, because they have genetic factors that allow them to interact more strongly with their hosts for good or for ill.
But there are some strains that have a special means of injecting something between the gastric cells that causes inflammation, which other strains don't.
It's a thing called CAG-A. Right. But you could see CAG-A as a virulence factor. That is certainly the way it's been interpreted. But it's also those same strains that confer the lower risk of esophageal cancer and so on.
Yeah. Wow.
So the last time I spoke to Marty
I'm trying to make good ones and bad ones just like we always do.
Exactly. We
and
always
I'm wrong.
Want heroes and,
I'm wrong.
And villains. Yeah. And yes, we are wrong. And you know, Blazer, the last time I spoke to him about this, billed them more as interaction factors rather than virulence factors. Mm-hmm. You know, they allow them to have this connection with their host, and that can have good and bad sides.
They can grab onto the cells better, apparently, mm-hmm. with this particular mechanism. That's fascinating. So my father recently had a bad appetite. He's an elderly fellow, otherwise in good health, and his doctor insisted he take big-time antibiotics to get rid of Helicobacter.
Right.
What do you think about that?
My God, I think...
it's happening all the time.
I think we are so crude and clumsy in the way we try and manipulate the microbiomes within us without a firm understanding of their ecology, their evolution, even who's there. And I think that hopefully we're going to get better at this and smarter and savvier about this in the next few decades or so.
Huge industries now growing up to give us probiotics, starting with active yogurts mm-hmm. and all kinds of things.
Yeah.
Where is that headed, do you think?
Well, so that, again, has a very old history. It goes back through more than a century now. And unfortunately, I think... probiotics seem to be very good for some kinds of infectious diarrhea and a few other minor conditions, but they are medically underwhelming. So they don't seem to be good or consistently good for a lot of the conditions that have been linked to the microbiome. And I think that's because, again, we are thinking about these problems as if they were simple. We're thinking about them as if they were, say, a vitamin deficiency, where you have a hole in your lifestyle that you plug with a fruit
Make
or a
it
vitamin.
Simple.
Yeah, you know, it's simple arithmetic. You lack this, add it, boom, you're better. But this is about changing entire worlds full of living, evolving organisms. So a probiotic contains far, like orders of magnitude, fewer microbes than already exist in the gut. They contain species that were chosen for historical reasons rather than those that are really good at colonizing the gut. And they often include heavily industrialized proprietary strains. Mm-hmm. So it's like releasing captive bred animals in very small numbers into the wilderness and expecting them to thrive without any assistance whatsoever. Of course they die, or they have no, very little impact on the world around them. And you see that with probiotics. A lot of the strains there pass through us. They don't establish themselves. They don't form long-lasting colonization. So they might have a bit of an impact, but they seem to be at the moment such a crude way of trying to manipulate these very complicated ecosystems within us.
There's so much good science that needs to be done. I was at a meeting last week where someone was talking about his wife having surgery, and the doctor insisted on her doing a chlordane or antibiotic scrub on her incisions, or her incision site, for every day for 2 weeks ahead of time.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked it up and found that that kind of preparation actually increased the rate of infection.
Mm-hmm.
So then he had her put yogurt on the site every day for a week, claiming that there was a study showing that that was dramatically reducing the rate. These are all good ideas, but could we please test them all?
Absolutely. I totally agree with that. And can we please test them all in, you know, large...
Double-blind control trials
that are statistically powered to show, you know, good effect, all that sort of thing. I think we aren't there yet. And I would very much like us to be, because there's so much medical potential here. But I think we are away from truly realizing it. Mm. And I think we're away from realizing it because people... And I feel that this happens a lot more for people from medical and clinical backgrounds who are sort of underappreciating how complex these communities can be. You know, we need to understand if we want to add beneficial microbes to a person's body, you need to know how those will cooperate to compete with the microbes.
I thought bifido were good and other things are bad.
Right. You know, everyone thinks that, like, you know, we put them in easy buckets of good and bad microbes. You know, we forget that they need to establish themselves in a new environment, that they need to interact with the native species that are there. They need food sources as well. What are they going to eat? All these questions that I think influence the success or failure of these therapies are not really being taken into account yet. And they will be. They will be, because people with backgrounds in ecology and evolution are coming into these fields and bringing those sorts of specialities into otherwise just purely clinical settings.